questions on that is about, you know, do I know that the trust has a, you know, I mean, an anti-fraud policy, or do I know how to, or do I know how to report any concerns, or do I report any concerns? And that kind of gives you barometer. I reckon if you went and asked all the staff individually one to one, they say, oh yeah, of course we would. But I think if you do it kind of anonymously in a staff survey, that does give you a better barometer or thermometer, if you like, I think is the word I'm looking for, in terms of, you know, being whether people would report it or not.
The vast majority of those money that are Yes, thank you, Chair. This is an update form that members requested my reply in March, and it follows on from the earlier conversation with regards to some outstanding actions with regards improvements to the Council's IT infrastructure and resilience of residents. It also provides more detail with regards to some progress in relation to information governance. And so the report really just provides a very short summary with regards to some of the five key areas that members were advised about in January, and then this paragraph 3.1. Just walking through those specific issues in turn, and George is able to provide a more update with regards to the IT contingency and disaster recovery. We have arrangements in place and discussions are ongoing with regards to looking at how we improve both the IT contingency and disaster recovery. Discussions are in hand with regards to travel with regards to different data set. There is a project plan which is set out in the Appendix 1 that is progressing as
systems and infrastructure. We're also taking the opportunity to simplify the infrastructure to enable better support to that infrastructure. So currently what we've done is we've joined Emergency Travel via fiber, and we're looking at then we've got a project to virtualize the what's called the DSL, the way people communicate externally with us. There was 33 servers in that DMZ, we reduced it down to about 3 or 4. So all this is about compressing our footprint so that when we go over to Mersey Travel, it'll be a lot simpler. Partners come on board and they're now planning out the next bit of the phase, which is to take the 170 odd services that we deliver out of our current data centre and transfer them over, our production services, over to Mersey Travel. So we'll get the firm dates when they've gone through the evaluation of the 175 of these services and how we get that over the over to the Mersey Travel.
This is adding focus, this is allowing us to bring cable to that.
Yeah.
The basement of the power tower block that can be demolished on that site release. It also addresses the real serious issues the council's had for some years about the data center.
absolute nightmare. So, you know, I kind of really welcome that, you know, it's nice to see a date there, that it's going to be September, you know, that it's kind of, we've got, you know, we've got that same. But I just wanted to ask a question, if I may, about the recent cyber attack and what impact, if any, it had on the council systems.
Council were not affected.
Okay.
But some of the services that were delivered from the NHS were affected.
Yeah.
So that stopped people getting into our network.
Yeah.
During that period of time, we increased, we constantly monitored through that time and made sure everything was packed, everything was up to date, and we took all the contingency we could do.
Yeah.
We were not affected at that time. We had no loss of services. The Science Centre, I think, did lose services because they blocked.
Yeah.
The NHS were locked coming in through that.
Yeah.
Obviously, we don't want to bring in the problems that we have. Digital really sort of made sure that we weren't affected. But we're only as good as the last time we did all the updates and all the rest of it. And we're it's a constant battle to make sure that we don't get hit.
Yeah.
But the NHS and the NHS. And all the desktops are all encrypted and all.
that specific piece of information to find that out and send it to me.
I just have the version to note. What's the point if you can't do it?
The process has changed a bit over these years. The section on the section 2 that sets up the background back in December 2013, we changed a couple of procedures, not procedures. Then came in. The process called off the decision notices came at that stage. I think about 12 months ago, the revenue team called to be called back on the exceptions we made and the decision made on the decision notice. At that time, we moved into a new process, which is again the new rule that came out on 1st of April 2016, which brought in this notion of something called the PRAS, which is a procedure rules, approval documents. There are four different types of documents that can be done, but have things about the extensions, exceptions, waivers, and so on. In bringing that in with the new rules, you can see the training exercise on the table by the Procurement team that ran off from February to April last year. Since then, it's been used for the e-learning package as well. That came out in November 16. And a number of staff so far have taken advantage of that. I think 50% are completed by the end of the calendar year, the calendar year. So this report brings together all the crags that have been issued during the 12-month period. I recommend there's probably all recommendations that come 6 months. Just looking at the report here, I think it comes with 42 crag notices issued during that year. And they are detailed in the appendix, ranging from the 69 exceptions, 47 exceptions, and so on. But to put that in context, this is 142 crag notices issued in the year. During the same year, it was 18,400 orders put to the Procurement system. To put it in context, that's a sort of balance. In terms of in orders, which go through the process as well, therefore you provide a proper procedure, that's about £20 million worth of spend in terms of that for the last financial year. I'd say the appendices there detail all the different crafts that have been issued by the various categories. It's essentially noted. Members have any questions on any specific items, I'll do my best to answer them, but I might have to come back with more detail later. So this phase of course is for noting, and I'm recommending that this comes 6 months in the future as well as lots of items in the evening.
Okay, well, we've heard what the recommendations are. Any questions?
Just a very quick one, Chair. Who is responsible for taking responsibility, if you like, for the exceptions that have been allowed to take place? Because one of those would have happened if it was during the pressure mechanism. How is it organised? Is it a procedure for going through the exception process?
This feature was open to each tool, so everything goes through alternative process among the crowd, one, two, three, and fours. It either goes through the head of procurement for approval, or sort of through the sign off by myself or one of my senior managers. So it's signed off by the line manager, who has to approve the form to be set in there. And rather before, we used to get, it was a couple of years back, people would fill out the different ones, 4 or 5 pages. It's now a series of, has somebody done X, doesn't one thing this? As a procedure and follow, and then it's then signed off by the senior manager, who's then going to approve by the head of procurement and the
self-contracting. So it's sort of counter signed by two individuals.